So, welcome to all of you. So, my name is Sebastian Schaubach. I'm from Data Physics, and we are a manufacturer of a wide range of technologies in order to characterize liquids and solid surfaces. And today I want to introduce to you a little bit where I see a pretty good overlap with our technology and inkjet applications. Maybe at the beginning, a very short overview. So we are located in Germany. We have been founded a bit more than 20 years ago. We have subsidiaries in the United States and also in India, and we are represented basically worldwide. So our butter and bread business is this kind of optical contour analysis systems. You can use the systems to characterize solid surfaces and also liquids. I explain a little bit more in a moment, but we also do classical tensiometers, for example, or spinning drop tensiometers. So this is a technology that you need if you have extremely low interface tensions that you want to measure. Then in addition, we have humidity generating systems, stability analysis systems for dispersions and also suspensions. And we have this kind of surface profile analyzer with an extremely high resolution in the Z direction. So what I want to introduce today is, I want to talk a little bit about this OCA. I want to show you how we can teach the system to make drops in the picoliter range. I want to explain to you how the drop volume is affecting the surface property that we are measuring. And then I want to show you how, for a test print, we can use the surface profile analyzer in order to see the amount of deposited material that we have on the surface. So just imagine you are jetting some drops of ink on the surface, you let the solvent evaporate, and then you get a solid residue on this. And with the surface profile analyzer, we can even see these tiny spots and measure the height, for example, and the dimension. So I'll show you a couple of examples for this. And yes, let's get started. So first of all, when we are thinking about the printing process, of course, we want to minimize the development cost, and how can modern measurement equipment help you with this? Well, what we can do is we can do a so-called wetting analysis. So we can measure the contact angle of your ink drop on a substrate. Can be paper, can be glass, can be metal, can be basically anything. What we can do in addition, of course, we can also characterize the ink. So we can make a surface tension analysis, and we can divide the surface tension into two parts. So one part is a polar contribution from polar interaction in the ink. One is dispersed interactions. And when we do the same thing for the solid surface, also characterize it regarding its polarity, then we can predict how well they will match. You know from chemistry, same like same. So if you have a polar surface, you have a polar ink, then you have a match, and then the adhesion is good. So if you can study your solid material and your ink at the same time, then you can optimize both parameters. So either increase the polarity or reduce the polarity of the ink, or change the surface treatment, for example, of your solid material. Okay. What you can also do is you can then make a test print and just see whether it's working or not. First of all, a little bit in general to the contact angle measurement. So we can have a couple of different cases. So when we jet a drop on a surface, you can either get a complete spreading. We don't want to have this because then the picture is not clear. You can have here a bad wetting. We also don't want to have this because then you are using a very big amount of the ink only to cover a small surface area. So the contact angle measurement, it can teach you for which liquid solid combination you have an ideal wetting. So I would say an ideal wetting is when you have a contact angle of around 20 or 30%, because then you're using a really low amount of the liquid and you don't have a complete spreading and the blurring of your picture. But the contact angle measurement, it can also teach you a couple of things about the interaction between the liquid and the solid. So this is the so-called Young equation here. And you can see this sigma S, so this is the solid surface free energy. This is a property only of the solid material. You have here the surface tension of your ink, only a property of the liquid phase. But then you also have this so-called solid liquid interaction term. So this term is teaching you basically something about the interaction between your liquid phase and your solid phase. Well, and you see, from this equation, the contact angle plays here an important role. So yeah, contact angle we can measure, surface free energy we can also measure, calculate from the measurement, and sigma L, surface tension, we can also directly measure it. So those terms in here, we can measure them and calculate them in order to characterize your interaction between liquid and solid material. The equipment that you can use to do this is an optical contour analysis system like our OCA 200 here. So what you are doing is you have here a mobile sample stage. This is number two. You have a dosing system to dose very well precisely controlled amounts of liquid. So this would be your ink. You have a camera system here, a light source opposite. And well, you need a computer, of course, to do the calculation and automatically show you the contact angle that you have measured. Importantly, for the printing process, since you are working with extremely small volume picoliter range, we are having here a microscopic optic. So with this optics, it's very easy to make drops visible that are less than 10 picoliters, for example. But you can imagine with the syringe-based system, it's not possible to dose the drops in the picoliter range. So I show you something very nice. Just before, very quickly, if your volumes do not matter, you can generate a drop with a syringe, find the contour, find the drop shape, and from this you can get the contact angle, okay? But there's a little limitation. So if you have a perfectly flat surface, like a silicon wafer, for example, and you place a drop of liquid on it, then no matter how big this drop of liquid is, you will always measure exactly the same contact angle. So we have macroscopic drops, microscopic drops on a silicon wafer, the contact angle for water is always the same. But now we take a paper, and paper is not ideally flat. So paper rather looks like this. So we have a rough surface. You saw from the device that I just now showed you, we are looking from the side at this paper. Okay, this is a piece of paper. We have a drop of liquid, and the only thing you can do is you can look at it from the side. So this will mean if there is a surface structure like a roughness in the plane of the drop, what your equipment will measure is this so-called apparent contact angle here on the left side in light green. But what you actually need to have in order to study your surface is this red contact angle here. So this is the real contact angle. So this means if you want to simulate a printing process and you want to study what is happening with the ink on a solid material, then you have to try to push the dimensions of your drops towards the dimensions that later on is applied in your inkjet process. Because then, you can see it from this picture here, then the roughness of the surface is taken out of the equation and your drop finds a smooth surface area again. Good, but how do we generate so small drops? So I can show you. What we do is we use a so-called picoliter dosing system. So in here you have a little cartridge. So this little cartridge is a disposable article. You fill it with your testing ink. This can be a suspension, does not matter, and still come out. And then in this device, you are generating an ultrasound pulse. And this little plastic cartridge has an air reservoir on top. So when you generate the ultrasound pulse, you are generating a little overpressure. And from this overpressure, a tiny droplet is shooting out of the nozzle from this small cartridge. And then this can go down to 15 picoliters depending on the liquid that you're using. So with water, for example, you can go even lower, around 10 picoliters. With higher viscous liquids, it's higher amounts that you can minimum dose. You can shoot this drop with around a frequency of 1000 hertz. So you can print tiny lines here. So this little example that you see here, this is a sent as a comparison. This one is, for example, a metallic ink that we are shooting on here. So in order to make the circuit board, for example. Okay, so we can use very tiny amounts of the liquid. We can dose them at high frequencies and then we can analyze them. I want to show you now how with this kind of technology we emulate a little printing process. So just to let you know, these drops here are a couple of hundred picoliters that we make. So this is fairly big drops because this conductive ink, it has a fairly high viscosity, in fact. I think there are some polymeric binders inside. Okay, so I want to show you a little video how this is going. So first, this one is a little bit decelerated. So you can see we are moving automatically the substrate underneath. and we are chatting with this little nozzle, Picoli, that drops onto the surface. Oops, I'm sorry, the presentation went out. One moment. Okay. Show you the second one. Here, we just put the drops a little bit closer to each other. So now you can see we are printing a line now here. But after we have printed this line or the individual dots, we were interested in when your solvent is evaporating, how is the solid material then deposed on the surface? Because you can imagine when we measure contact angle, this is always a completely fresh drop. So the solvent has not yet evaporated. But what happens after the evaporation? So what we did is we did a topography analysis after the jetting process. I want to tell you a little bit about the topography analysis, why it's important, because there is two reasons to do this. In fact, with a topography analysis, you can also get a so-called correction factor. So this is an R value, so this is a roughness value of the surface you can measure for your paper. And with this, you can correct the apparent contact angle to get the real contact angle. So this is one approach to get the correct contact angle, or you choose the drops so little that they are smaller than the dimensions of the roughness, which would be the second approach. But what else we can do with a topography analysis? We can, of course, check on the printed lines that we have made. So a little example here. So you can see we have printed here lines with different weights and heights. And you can see even if the lines are just in the nanometer range, the resolution of the equipment I will show you in a moment, at least in the Z direction, is still high enough. You can also see this one here in X and Y direction, the resolution for this kind of system is lower. So we have very, very extremely precise height information, but I think for printing processes where the drops are typically quite big, so a couple of micrometers wide, but extremely shallow in the height, this is the right equipment to check on it. So I want to quickly show you what happens after the ink has dried when we do this kind of topography analysis. So we did the analysis with a surface profile analyzer. So the system works like this. This is a box with powerful graphic cards inside to do the calculation because you're generating a lot of images. Here you have a sample stage where you put your sample on. And then here, this is the measurement head. And this measurement head, it has a so-called Miro objective. So with the Miro objective, we are splitting the beam in two parts. And basically you are having here this kind of reference mirror, which is mobile. So the reference mirror is moved up and down a little bit in order that the beam splitter gets a recombined beam at the end. So like this, we can get a very high resolution for the height. Basically, the system then does it like this. So the objective is movable with a piezo control. And then we are having an object with a certain height and we are just taking pictures at different heights. Okay, so the piezo is lowering and raising the objective and we take pictures along the road. So you can see there is a certain spacing between the pictures. And typically the spacing that we are using is around 200 nanometers. But the interesting thing is, even with a spacing of only 200, of very high number, 200 nanometers, we can go down to a height resolution of around 0.1 nanometer because we are generating interference patterns on the surface. Okay, so you have these patterns here from interfering light that are recombined here in the objective. And with this signals that we get out from here, and the calculation that runs in the background producing a lot of data, we can get an extremely high height resolution, okay? We are not only scanning layer by layer, we scan layer by layer and make an interference image on the surface at the same time. Okay, but what is then happening? Maybe to quickly show you some different technology, maybe you know the focus variation or converse Kahle microscopy. There, the height resolution is typically in the higher nanometer range. We are using a so-called white light interferometry. So we are producing interferogram on the surface of the material. And with this, you can go down to an extremely high resolution in the Z direction. But very importantly, you can see in our case here, for all the objectives that you can use, the height resolution is always exactly the same, but the resolution in the X and the Y direction, they depend on the objective. So you can use objectives like a 100X objective, then you have an extreme low point spacing also in X and Y direction of around 100 nanometers. But if you work with a normal objective here, so typically 5X or 10X, you are around 1 micrometer resolution in X and Y direction. Okay. What is the advantage? So I have a little example for you here. So this is a picture from this kind of material surface with an optical microscope. So you just see gray and white. You use an electron microscope, you see a little bit of structure, or you use a surface profile analyzer, and then the whole thing becomes a three-dimensional model. And you have very precise height information and also the white information on it. Okay, so we can generate a 3D map of this kind of objects here. Now, the interesting thing, how precise is it really when you apply it? And well, a perfectly smooth surface is normally a silicon wafer if it's polished. The picture you see in here, this is indeed a silicon wafer, and you see there is a line going through the silicon wafer. Maybe you know, one method to assess the roughness and the surface profile is based on a metal stylus, so a very, very thin needle basically, that is moving over the surface and scanning the surface profile. So this wafer was before scanned with this kind of needle device, and you can see now we make an intersection here with this line. This measurement method has generated a gap in the surface that is around 0.4 nanometers deep. Okay, so with this extreme resolution in the Z direction, we can even detect the smallest change to the surface. Also here, you have different standards, so you can print different lines and you can analyze them regarding their thickness here and also regarding their height. But I told you what I actually want to show you is how do the drops look like of this metallic ink that we have jetted onto the surface with our OCA200. And well, you observed we are generating very nice drops here, but we get out the coffee ring effect. So what you see after the liquid has evaporated your solvent, you form this kind of rings on the surface. When we make a cut through one of these rings, you can see the height of the material that we are deposing on the surface is around 400 nanometers. You can also see the diameter of each drop is in the 150 micrometer range. So this means in this direction, we can go down to around 1 micrometer resolution. So there is still plenty of space. And in the height, we can also still go down by a factor of more than 1,000 for higher resolutions. So even with this relatively big drops, a couple of hundred picoliters, we can very, very well see how the shape of these drops and the deposed material can be analyzed. Okay, and also smaller drops are very easily possible, no problem at all. How about the line that we have printed? So in the liquid state, it looked very, very nice. Also, when you look with the bare eye at it or with the normal optical microscope, it's a nice line that you have printed on the surface. But in fact, also in here, the particles migrate to the border when the liquid is evaporating, and we are generating 2 lines here on the surface. So here, the height is much higher. Maybe you remember from the circles we had before that it was around 400 nanometers height. Now we are around 1,500 nanometers in height. And also here you see the parameters for the widths of one of these lines. So I would guess this is around 20 micrometer around. Okay. So with a surface profile analyzer, we can really get extremely detailed three-dimensional information on deposed inks on a surface, okay? Of course, this is not possible if your ink is absorbing into the material. So if you print on a piece of paper, for example, and your ink goes in, I'm not sure whether you can get much value and information from this kind of measurement. But here, when you print on a solid material, you really see the height information. So I think for inkjet applications, the combination of this kind of OCA200 optical contour analysis system with a picoliter dosing and then a surface profile analysis. It can really give you some interesting information on the on the printing pattern that you have produced, especially for electronics applications. Yes, and now before I'm open for questions, I want to show you very, very briefly one more device that I think overlaps pretty well with your needs in the ink development. So this is an optical stability analysis system. So maybe you know people very often they do the shelf life testing. So they mix a formulation, shake it a bit, put it in the shelf, and after a couple of days or weeks, they come back and they check whether anything has sedimented or whether there's any optical change happening or not. Highly subjective, of course. What we can offer in contrast to this is an optical system that can do the stability analysis for you. So what you would do is you take your ink formulation, for example, you fill it into a testing vial, also you shake it a bit, and then you place it into this kind of scanning tower. And inside the scanning tower is an array of a light source that shines light through your samples and goes on the other side to a detector. So you can measure the transmission. Interestingly, we do not do this only in one plane of the sample, but we scan the whole sample height. So this means if you get a sedimentation, for example, then after a certain time here in the lower area of the sample where the particles are accumulating, there will be no transmission anymore because the light cannot go through because the particles are there. However, on top, then you can go through with the light. So we can calculate a sedimentation kinetics, for example, or you can also, if there is an agglomeration happening, also the intensity of the transmission is changing because then you have bigger particles available, but a smaller amount. So you also see this. So with this kind of analysis system, you can very easily see stability issues with your material. But, well, an ink is supposed later on to be seen by the people. So this means most probably, I would guess your ink formulation, you have zero chance to shine through with the light. Yeah? So there is no chance to measure transmission. So this kind of system has a second detector inside, a backscattering detector. This is 45 degrees to the light source. So this would be here in this position. So what we are doing is with very high intensity, we shine light into the sample, but not high energy light. So it's only around 870 for the nanometers wavelength light. We shine it into the sample. And if the light hits particles in there or oil droplets, they get scattered and we detect this backscattering signal. And also from the backscattering signal, the information you get from it, it's complementary to the transmission signal that you get. But transmission you can only measure if you have extremely low particle concentrations or oil concentrations. And with the backscattering, you can measure also very, very high solid content changes. So even if you go up to higher than 10% solid content, in our brochure, we write 95% solid content, you can still see the changes with this kind of system if there is a sedimentation or agglomeration process happening. So I think this is a very valuable system because it can speed up your formulation development very much. The optical system is extremely sensitive, so changes much less than 1%, only 0.1% you can already see. So the slightest move of particles inside or the slightest change in particle size, you will recognize it with the system very easily. So typically we do not do any measurements that are longer than a day or two. Most of the problems we can already solve by measuring for a couple of hours, and then you already see stability issues where with the bare eyes you would have waited a couple of days or even weeks until you see them. So this is really a valuable system to speed up your development. So at the same time, parallel, you can measure six samples. So each of the samples can be set at an individual temperature electronically and circulator-based controlled. So I think this is great for formulation optimization. So if you have any issues with your optimization, just let us know, send us some sample, and then our guys here, they can very easily prove you that this is really a great system. So I hope, even so this is of course a marketing presentation, I hope you still learned a little bit about what is technically possible, and I hope it sparked a little bit your interest. in looking deeper into your ink and printing patterns with our technology, and just let me know if you have any questions. So thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Sebastian. It's very interesting. And I think it relates actually very nicely, particularly the stability equipment, to what Alan was saying in the talk earlier on about ink stability and agglomeration and sedimentation and things like that. So hopefully that gave some resonance.